and the environment are not two ends of the spectrum.
The guard is way ahead a lot of what we do.
This is just the start of more things to come.
If we can contribute to betterment of our whole culture and nation, then the average person can too.
Time DNR came to us, we had a yard full of M60 tanks and 113 carriers that we were waiting disposition on. In other words, we were the salvage yard and we needed to get rid of the equipment.
Some things are lighter weight metal, and scrapping them, the cost isn't that expensive. With the APCs and the tanks, they're very heavily armored, which means they're very thick. So taking a torch and trying to cut them like you would a container, for example, isn't going to work.
The initial attempt was to bring the South Carolina Army National Guard and DNR together. To the best of my knowledge right now, we are the only viable reflex project where we are actually using the military's inventory of excess equipment.
The initiation of this concept came out of the Gulf of Mexico, and it was called the Rigs to Reefs program. And that's when a drilling operation or a drilling rig operation reaches its lifeline, why they have to take it out of the sea. Well, a former student conceived, but it cost $7 million to put it on the hill, as they say, and it only cost $3 million to clean it up and tip it over. They tip them over, and then that company would give LSU $1 million or $1.5 million for reef research each year.
The APCs were replaced by the Bradley fighting vehicle. The M60 tanks that we dropped were replaced by the M1s. So the equipment had become obsolete. There was no real use for it. So it was either going to sit in a yard, sit in a museum.
The only ones that we demill are the ones that are being discontinued.
And are these M60s?
No, these are what we call M110 Hollisters. We have demill these also. We have two bays in the back reserved just for demill. That's as a personnel carrier, that's a M113A3. The version that we are demilling is basically the same vehicle, but we are doing the A1 and A2 model. This is the beginning stage. The vehicle is exactly like this when we get it. This vehicle will be completely stripped. Power pack will be pulled out of it. All the oil levels will be drained. Anything in this vehicle to float will be taken out. It'll be steam cleaned and pressure washed to get all the oil film out of the vehicle. And then it'll be ready to be dumped in the ocean.
Well, all the excess material that comes out is put into a storage bin and it's recycled. All our oil, the hydraulic fluid, all the fuel that's left in the engine tanks are all taken out.
These engines are sent to depot to be rebuilt, to be reused.
The reason that APCs and tanks make good reef material, the weight, obviously. They're very heavy, they're not going to move around. Doing this takes nothing away from natural reefs. If anything, it creates a healthier reef system.
What would you say to people who say that dropping these military vehicles into the ocean is not environmentally sound?
We went through, saw how they were doing it, saw the demilling process, the inspections they were going through, and we were satisfied that there wouldn't be any adverse environmental impact from it.
Equipment is thoroughly clean. It's inspected. It's inspected once we get it down to port before it even goes on the barge.
The Department of Natural Resources has their own environmental personnel that check them before they're dumped.
We have inspections that go on year-round looking at all of our facilities, making sure that we meet those permitting standards.
The person that normally gets the contract to, you know, haul them out, they in turn also check for environmental issues.
We have the environmental review process that we talked about. We have a section that does nothing but compliance stuff, going out to our facilities, making sure we're not polluting.
As far as the environment is concerned, I don't think you can find a safer program that's going on, particularly when it comes to water.
You know, we've had some misconceptions when folks talk about artificial reefs. that folks talk about how if you create an artificial reef, it's somehow taking away from a natural reef.
There are people that don't like the concept of artificial reefs because they think you're dumping materials. But I've been diving for 40 years, and I've been diving a lot on artificial reefs. The reef you see down there, in terms of the fish that you see, the organisms that are growing on the material, are the exact same organisms and fish that grow on a naturally occurring geologic formation.
It's very difficult to differentiate. You might have a difference in some of the encrusting organisms. You'll have a difference what goes on to steel versus what goes on to concrete. But in the long term, probably not. I haven't seen documentation of that.
Corals and things that are on there are what are termed broadcast spawners. So they kind of throw all their stuff up into the water column. It floats along into what finds a hard substrate to settle on. So along the coast of South Carolina, there aren't that many hard substrates.
We have uneven sandy bottoms, and there's nothing there for vegetation really to grow on.
We use the GPS to find the location that we want to dive on. It's extremely accurate, so what we do is run to the coordinates, then they look for some kind of relief on the bottom with the bottom recorder. They get on top of the structure, they'll signal us, and he'll throw that anchor.
What we normally do when we put material like this out, we don't just put the structure out and then just leave it. We try and monitor it and keep up with how it's doing. So we do periodic dives like this. We get down and we look at the growth on the structure that we put out, fish counts, and we take underwater video so we can see how productive these reef sites are.
Well, our shallowest reef's actually in about 10 feet of water, but they go as deep as 110 feet of water.
Typical dive, a lot of the normal fish that we normally see. Small grouper, which is good. In addition to all the schools of bait fish, it's good to see the juveniles of fish that will get bigger. Things like small grouper, small blackfish.
It's kind of a close-up. There's actually a fish there, which didn't show very well. What I saw down there was very encouraging. You saw a lot of encrustation around the entire vehicle. I saw very little bare metal. Sea slug.
Oh my gosh. That thing.
Yeah, the sea slug came up pretty good. I'm happy with it. The incrustation, the things growing on it are what you're looking for. The little things growing on there are what feeds the fish, the little fish, and the little fish feed the big fish, and on up the chain.
There's a lot of business associated with supporting recreational and commercial fishing. Commercial fishermen like them because they know that the snappers and groupers spawn on these habitats, and the juveniles are provided cover for their development.
One of the other big payoffs for taking on the ReefX project is that we get to employ some soldiers, keeping in mind that they are reservists, they're M-base soldiers, and a lot of them are unemployed at that time. In most cases, initially when it started, they were on as much as 8 months.
Working for the Guard's certainly been a symbiotic relationship for both agencies, not just from the reef construction, but also from the attention that it garners.
A number of the local Guard high-ranking officers work in natural resource agencies in South Carolina. They have very high posts in natural resource agencies in South Carolina.
They're outdoorsmen, they love to hunt and fish, which makes being a conservation manager really easy. They get what it is we're trying to do.
I think it comes down to local leadership. The local Guard is exactly that by definition. It's local. They are the people we work with day to day in our professional lives, some of whom we never even know they're Guard. I view the Guard, and I think most citizens do, is it's our unit. It's the local unit. It's our people.
And I feel comfortable saying I think the Guard is way ahead in a lot of what we do.
It's like that whole vigilante sort of like investigative journalism sort of aspect I like about it.
He adds credibility to the doc because he's outside of the ReefX program. He's not part of the National Guard. He's not part of DNR.
Now, I've had an interest in film since I was about 10.
So are you nervous about doing your first interview in 3 hours?
With the car?
A little bit.
And why are we up so early?
Because we're going to the coast, going on a boat to film.
They all seem really nice and really passionate about what they're doing.
What are we doing out here today?
We're practicing how to walk backwards and hold a camera.